Hi everyone, pajama investors now pile into silver, Chinese economy slows and Eurodollar finds buyers just below 121. Here are your hot topics for the day. Now, new week, new target for the retail short squeeze army of Reddit's WallStreetBets. So on Sunday, it was this time the turn of silver coins and bars, which were taken by assault by your Reddit Wall Street's hungry bettors. So we've seen big outlets where you can buy these coins and bars were unable to process orders until markets opened in Asia. And as soon as the markets opened, silver jump started the week, hitting $29 per ounce as these pajama traders pile into the metal they considered as undervalued in a mass move as the one we have seen on GameStop shares last week. So this time though, the move didn't come as a pure surprise as last week's rush to iShares Silver Trust has thrown the foundation of what we saw on Sunday. So from a pricing perspective, we had already discussed the fact that silver lagged behind gold amid an impressive flight to safety sent the yellow metal to its all-time highs last year, so by $2,000 levels. I leave the link of an old article down here for those who are actually interested to read more about this silver story. But quickly speaking, the empirical data shows that the gold-silver ratio stands near 60 in average, and the price of an ounce of silver could have well consolidated within the $30-$32 band, given that the gold price rallied massively to $2,000 last year and it actually managed to hold ground near $1,800 per ounce. So therefore, the rise in silver doesn't seem far stretched to me just yet. So while it's not exactly the GameStop anomaly that we have seen last year, but it's clearly a hint that the retail traders who just discovered the strength of their unity are out there looking for new targets, and these targets are apparently bigger and bigger ones. So speaking of these new targets, one other name that we are all familiar with this time benefited of all this short squeeze frenzy last week. So that's American Airlines, which gained as much as 38% during the course of last week, just because these small investors wanted to fight back these big short sellers on various battlefields. So GameStop, American Airlines, now silver. But for silver though, even though I see nothing too shocking right now, the rally could be quite short-lived as some leading members of this Reddit Wall Street Bets platform are already divided over the question, and some of them advise against the move in silver. So for those of you who have this FOMO, you know, the fear of missing out these huge rallies, there is one important thing that you should remember. That's that if you lose full support and momentum in this market, then it's over. So we can see that the speculative betting is a prosperous business, but it's dangerous as well. If someone pulls the rug from under your feet and it happens quite in a fast fashion, you can end up with significant losses. So please keep that in mind when you play this game. So now let's talk about the markets as a whole. So last week ended with decent losses actually in European and US indices. We have seen the S&P 500 and the Dow closing 2% lower on Friday as European indices were also heavily offered. Now it's quite better right now, but the stocks who were responsible for this general discomfort in the market finished the week strongly up. So I'm talking about GameStop and AMC Entertainment. Well, the good news is the retail traders are now bailing these companies out, these companies that have actually been heavily hit by the pandemic, and some of them are actually worth being saved. So the airline companies, to me for example, they are worth being saved. Otherwise governments who do that. So my take is not all negative. So what's happening right now is interesting, but more importantly, it also brings forward some crucial questions, such as, should we let this happen? Is it good bailing these companies? Some deserve, some they don't. So we see policymakers now, Senator Warren said, they need to take steps to ensure the prices would reflect fundamentals. Now, okay, good. But how do you do that? Because besides the concrete metrics that define a company's worth, such as earnings, sales, is CapEx, capital expenditure. And so there are values that could not be priced in objectively, also such as potential of growth seen by investors, the brand value, or the goodwill of a company, right? So if there is a way to temper the market anomalies, such as we've seen last week, so best is to attack the problem at its source, right? So that's preventing Wall Street from short selling these stocks in the first place. That way, only those who believe in a company's good fortune would buy the stocks. Those who don't just wouldn't buy, or they would sell whatever shares they have in their hands, but they cannot simply bet against a company and obviously gather the fury of your pajama traders out there. Well, of course, these guys are not there to get things straight, but they're there to make money, right? They're there to take some profit from Big Wolf's pockets into their own, and that's fine. That's basically your Adam Smith's invisible hand, but back to how to prevent all this from happening, we doubt there would be any restriction of sort for Wall Street, like forbidding short sellers, which actually would cause even more market volatility as investors would interpret any restriction of a kind as an attempt to their freedom. And you don't want to do that. So back to the market, the mood was somewhat better in Asia this morning as most Asian indices kicked off the week on a positive note, somehow pulling these European and US indices higher as well. But the short-term trends remain quite shaky and your gains may remain on a slippery ground as the volatility actually rises right now on the back of this retail-led short squeeze frenzy. So we see that when we look at the S&P 500 futures, they reverse 1% of losses before stepping into the green zone. So there's still some discomfort there. All this though, one thing I can say is you clearly don't want to be a short seller in Wall Street right now. Now, we can see these tensions rising in the main street as the ongoing retail revolt is shaking up the big stock indices big time. So the VIX, which is the most famous volatility index, which is computed on the S&P 500 futures, is up to its highest levels since November, hinting at an inevitably rising stress in the market. So the volatility is certainly here to stay before the dust settles, and we see no concrete action other than temporary trade restrictions to cool things off in the immediate future, because anything more than that would have broader implication for everyone, including the big US indices, and not necessarily in a desired fashion, given how these indices are artificially ballooned and do certainly not perfectly reflect what you call their fundamentals either, to be honest with you. So my best guess with this story is Wall Street will need to learn how to live with it. So given the new market trend, so the trend of these mass purchases on one stock, which has been shorted by Wall Street, the weeks ahead will still see some impressive rallies here and there, and most of the time probably where you expect the least, and take investors by surprise. So we will get to know a multitude of companies that we never heard of probably, and well, you know, that will at least change the ritual of speaking about these big US tech companies only and how they rally and, you know, all that same story. Now let's move on to the economic data, because we don't want to talk only about the short squeeze folly. We still need to follow what's going on the economic front. So the big news of this Monday is a slowing China. So the Caixin, China manufacturing PMI fell to a 7-month low, so faster than expected by analysts, hinting that the only bright spot of the world economy could now also succumb to the renewed COVID pressure on its economic activity. Well, the thing is, the economic activity is normally slower in China into this Chinese New Year holiday, which is the biggest during the year. So cities literally empty and no one is around. So your favorite favorite food shops are closed and you can't even find taxis or DDs, which is actually the Chinese version of Uber, in the streets. You would never see big cities like Beijing or like Shanghai so quiet. But now it appears that this year we could see an even more severe than usual slowdown in the run-up and during these Chinese festivities, as the Chinese population will not be traveling to see their loved ones this year. And that's some 800 million Chinese who won't be traveling, eating, drinking, and gambling together and offering gifts to each other and to their family. So that's going to have a weight on the economy. And speaking of the PMI figures elsewhere, the PMI data should also confirm a certain slowdown in European and US activity during the month of January as well. But a more significant contraction will likely hit services, as shops and restaurants have been the first defense line of this new lockdown measures that are going on. For example, in Switzerland, yesterday news revealed an impressive jump by more than 50% in restaurant sales, like actually restaurant sales, during the final quarter of 2020, and buyers are nowhere to be found right now. Now, finally, I'm just going to have a quick note on euro. So last week we were talking about the euro dollar testing the 121 support, but we continue seeing a strong dip buying interest below this level, even though some European Central Bank officials such as Knot said that the bank has tools to counter the ongoing euro appreciation. So the question is, how come the threat of softer monetary policy from the ECB doesn't work for the euro? So could the ECB pull the euro lower with new policy measures? Well, the answer is, for the euro policymakers, the question of the euro appreciation is a bit tricky. Well, in the first place, the ECB's board is clearly very much divided when it comes to monetary measures. Like, remember, Germany was attacking the ECB at the court last year because it thought its PSPP program, so its help economic help program, which is bond buying program, was not legal. So traders know that the ECB does not have unlimited margin to stretch, as it would be the case for the Fed, for example. So also the problem is, the euro is no longer a rate differential play. It is rather a hedge play. Investors buy euro not because they want to make money on it, but rather because they wanted to protect themselves against these market squeezes in uncertain times. So therefore, pulling the rates even lower may not necessarily discourage your euro bulls from buying and holding the single currency. So we may see some more upside move in the euro over the coming week. So that's it for today. Thanks for watching. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and insightful to you. Please do not hesitate to follow us on our Twitter and LinkedIn for regular market updates, and subscribe to our YouTube channel for more daily videos like the one you just watched. I see you tomorrow, and in the meantime, good day trading.